All right, so it's my pleasure to introduce Francesca Rossi, who's at the University of Padova and is also currently at the IBM T.J. Watson Research Center. Without further ado.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. Thanks for the organizer for inviting me. It's very nice to be here. Last year, I was at Radcliffe Institute for the whole year, so it's nice to be back in Cambridge and Harvard. Gives me nice memories. So, yes, so I'm an academic. So I work at the University of Padova in Italy, and for many years I've been working in AI, and especially constraint reasoning, knowledge representation, and group decision making. And now I've joined IBM T.J. Watson Research Center for 1 year, which is a very different environment, but still very interesting to see how the industry kind of research can collaborate with academia to deploy AI systems in the real world. So in this talk, I will try to address the issue of, given my expertise in group decision making, of how we can actually help groups making good decisions with AI tools. So, what are the main ingredients of an intelligent agent? So an intelligent agent, as we've seen many examples already in the talks that have been given so far this morning, so it needs to sense and acquire and make sense of the information that it perceives from the environment. And then based on them, it has its own goal given by us or learned during time. And then it has to choose a sequence of action to reach that goal in the best way, so following some sort of optimization criterion. And then, of course, this is not that simple, because there is a lot of missing data, wrong information coming from same source, and uncertainty from what can be done, can happen in the future. So they has to be able to deal with uncertainty. It has to adapt. It has to learn over time, because as we've seen, it would be nice that self-driving cars as well could learn over time to drive as better and better every day. And also, what is important for me, they need to cooperate with each other and also with people. So the issue that was raised even in the previous talk of interaction with people and among agents, artificial or not, is very, very important. So many things can fit this definition of an artificial agent, from very simple ones that we use every day to more and more complex ones. So even the GPS that we use in our cars or that we have on our phone is in some sense an intelligent agent. It is isolated, it does cooperate with anybody else. The environment is the current location where we are and the map. The goal is where we want to go. And then it has to choose the best actions in the sense of the route to follow to go from where we are to where we want to go. And to follow, to choose this best route, he uses usually a very well-known AI algorithm that is in every AI textbook. So there is not, doesn't really cope with uncertainty. If we make a mistake and we don't follow it, it just recomputes from scratch from where we are at that point. And so this is very simple. It has some ingredients of the ones that I told you about an intelligent agent. Of course, a self-driving car is a much more complex intelligent agent. We have already seen many, many features of intelligent cars. The environment is the same as a GPS, but many more sensors to sense, to make sense of what is around, other cars, pedestrians, weather conditions, you know, and lanes and everything. The goal, again, is to drive us safely and effectively through a certain destination. And then there are many more actions to take, because it will also decide on his own whether to turn, to accelerate, to decrease speed, to overtake, and so on. And there is a lot of uncertainty to handle, you know, what other people are doing, what cars will do, what the result of one action will be, and the consequences on the environment, and so on. So this is not an isolated agent, of course, because it has to deal with other agents with their own will, you know, to do, you know, what he's doing. Doing to drive around, and also pedestrians, but is making individual decisions. And as we saw earlier, you know, during the discussion time, it would be greatly, you know, helped by the fact that actually is not isolated anymore, that cars, self-driving cars, could talk to each other, and actually so this would solve many of the problems about uncertainty that we have today. So going one step further, let's go to agents that cooperate with each other to reach a certain goal. So they don't have their own individual goal only, but they also have a common goal for a set of agents. And a very simple example is these robots that play soccer. So here you have a team of robots, completely autonomous, that have to play soccer in the sense that they have to score some goals against another team. And of course, they have their own actions, individual actions for each or the individual robots that they have to take. But actually, they don't have an individual goal different from everybody else because they have a team goal, which is to win, you know, to score as many goals as possible. So there is, again, a lot of uncertainty about what the other team is doing, but where the ball is going and so on. But the point is here that you see these additional things that each robot has to cooperate and not just think about what is best for himself, but cooperate with the other team members to reach a common goal. So I think that it will become more and more pervasive the fact that we have artificial agents and also human agents to cooperate with each other to reach a common goal. And the reason is that we are more and more connected every day to other humans and machines through the social media, through any system that helps us make decisions. And we want more and more, because of these connections, to make decisions together with others. We also are in every day, you know, in situations where we want to make decisions, we need to make decisions together. And of course, there are many issues to be dealt already without the need of AI in the picture when a group of people make decisions, like we influence each other, we manipulate the system to make decisions, to get a better decision for us, and so on. So all these issues that have been studied in social sciences, political sciences, voting theory, game theory, and so on. But here, the point is that we are getting to a situation where humans, groups of humans making decisions, are going to be increasingly connected to machines, and machines will be in the picture of this decision-making process, because not only humans are connected, but also things are starting to be connected with the people and between each other. So group decision making has to do with the fact that there are could be several possible decisions, possible options, and one of them has to be made. And then you have a collection of agents, humans or not, that have each of them a preference ordering over the possible decisions. So I see all the options. So for example, suppose that there is a family that needs to buy a car. Of course, each member of the family has his own preferences and priority orders over what cars should be bought. And then these preferences of the agents need to be in some form aggregated, taking into consideration maybe with weights given to the various kinds of agents in some cases, but aggregated together in order to reach one decision, which is the collective decision for that group of people. So this is the overall very abstract and simplistic definition of group decision making. But I mean, the family needing to buy a car is just a very simple example. You can think of a hiring committee that has a lot of candidates. Each member of the committee has his own preferences over the candidates or features of the candidates, and then they have to choose one. Or web search engines that have to rank web pages according to some request, or recommender systems, or even just friends that have to go out for dinner, and there are many possible restaurants around, and you have to choose one out of many restaurants, depending on the preferences of the people, and possibly listening to everybody, and then coming up in some way to aggregate these preferences and to get to one the decision of one restaurant. So in this group, decision-making has been considered already a lot in AI, and there are many issues involved. For example, the first issue is how to model these preferences of the agents, because, as I said, in abstract concept, the preferences are just a way to describe your priorities over the possible options. But if you have a lot of options, of course, it's not feasible to request people to rank in a linear order the first choice, the second choice, and so on. And you cannot rank all the restaurants in Cambridge. And so you need some compact way of representing this kind of knowledge, preferences over a combinatorially structured set of objects. And there are many tools, frameworks that have been considered in AI. Some of them are named here, but the name doesn't matter. CPNet, soft constraints, utility function, real network, and they all differ from each other. I mean, they're not just different names from the same thing, even though they all try to represent preferences in a compact way. And they differ because they have different expressive power, different computational properties in terms of how computationally difficult it is to reason with the preferences once you represent them in that way. And they have different ways of handling uncertainty. They have different, they provide different tools to elicit and learn preferences from the various agents. And in general, they offer a trade-off. So of course, as you can predict, those that are more computationally effective, they have to make some trade-off in expressive power. Usually they are less expressive, but they are easier computationally to be used. So once you understand how you want to model your preferences for each of the agents, and maybe you want each agent to be free to model a preference with any framework they want, because maybe somebody likes to think about costs, somebody likes to think more qualitatively about features of the objects that you express his preferences on. So suppose that each agent decides how to model his preferences in a compact way. And then you need, as I said, the next step is to aggregate these preferences in order to get to a common collective decision. And many people in AI have looked at some other area, which is the area of voting theory, to say, okay, let's look at this aggregation problem, for example, as if it were like a political election. After all, the possible decisions are like the candidates. And then you have to choose one out of the set of possible candidates. The only difference here, there are some slight but important differences that usually in political election, for example, you have a lot of voters and very few candidates, while in AI scenarios, as I said, the decision set is usually combinatorially structured, so you have the opposite. You have few voters, few agents expressing the preferences, and a lot of candidates, so you have to account for that. But there are many voting rules that you can use. Here are just some of them that I named, the most natural that you can use, and plurality, border, approval, k-approval, many others. You see many strange names here. But the point is that there are many, many different ways of aggregating the preferences together. And they differ for how much of the preference they get from the agents. Some of them, they just get the top choice. For example, plurality just tells each agent, give me your top choice for each agent. And then the winner candidate decision is the one that gets more most top choices from the agent. So this is a very computationally effective way of combining the preferences of the agents, but it forgets everything except the top choice of each agent. So it forgets a lot of the preference information. The opposite is, for example, the second one that I wrote here, Borda. Borda considered the whole set of preferences for each agent, and then make some score calculation to decide who the winning election is. So in that case, you need the whole set of preferences, even if it's compactly represented, but still you need a lot more information to be able to get to a collective decision. And then you have something in between, approval, okay, approval, and others, so they differ because of that. But this is not the only difference among these different voting rules, ways of aggregating the preferences. Another important difference is the properties, the theoretical properties that these voting rules have. In fact, in voting theory, there is a lot of studies about these theoretical properties. And the reason is that since these rules are so many, people just came up with more and more voting rules over the years and centuries, and people then started to understand, okay, so but which one should I use then in my scenario, in my everyday, you know, political election, for example. So then these voting theory specialists, they started to list a set of desirable or undesirable properties of these voting rules, like you don't want a voting rule to be what they call a dictatorship, so that it elects always what one of the agents wants, no matter how the other people vote. Of course, you don't want that. Or you want another very desirable property is that you want your voting rule to be so-called unanimous, which means that if everybody agrees that the decision A is better than a decision B, then of course B cannot be the winner, the result of the collective decision, or many, many other properties. So these rules differ from these properties. And then, as some of you maybe you know are familiar with some of the most famous result in voting theory, there have been a lot of so-called impossibility results that tell us that if you want to combine some set of desirable properties, then even if these properties are very, you know, natural to want in a voting rule, unfortunately, the impossibility results tell us that there is no way that you can ever come up with any voting rule that satisfies these properties. A very famous example is the one by Arrow that says that there are three properties, and actually one of them is really not something that you cannot give up, so it's not really something that you can be worried about, but that says that a voting rule that is monotonic, that is unanimous, that is non-dictatorship cannot exist. But even another one, which I think is even more disturbing, is that every reasonable voting rule, with some very slight condition there, is manipulable. So it means that for whatever voting rule that you can come up with, there are situations, so preferences coming from agents, such that single agents can gain in terms of the result, collective result that comes out, by misreporting their preferences. Okay? So misreporting your preferences may give you a better result in terms of what you like, in terms of your preferences, as a collective result. And of course, this is something that you would not like to have in a voting rule. You would like to avoid the possibility of manipulation, but this result unfortunately tells you that there is no such voting rule. Okay? Of course, it doesn't mean that in every situation people can manipulate, but in every voting rule, there is at least a situation in which people can manipulate. And in fact, this result started a whole line of research within AI, where computational concerns, of course, are, you know, taken in consideration a lot, where people started to try to understand whether this is really a worrying result or not. And what people in AI say, okay, every voting rule is manipulable, but maybe some of them are computationally difficult to manipulate, meaning it is difficult for me, the one wanting to manipulate, it is computationally difficult for me to try to understand how to misreport my preferences in order to get a better result, and some of them instead are computationally easy to manipulate. So, of course, it would be desirable to use voting rules that are computationally difficult to manipulate. So, in this case, computational complexity, computational difficult hardness is actually good for the group decision system. But in general, so to give you just an idea of this space of these voting rules and ways to aggregate preferences. But in general, voting rules, so as I said, you just take the preferences of each agent and then it returns the collective decision. You can also have more complex scenarios, of course, where a voting rule actually does not return one decision, but it returns a ranking of all the decisions, given the preference of the user. But this is suppose we are in this simple scenario where you need to make one decision. So once you are in this space of group decision making, you start and you think also not just of human agents but also artificial agents, you start into getting into some possibly ethical considerations of which collective decision is actually taken. Because suppose that everybody prefers unanimously something which is not ethically good for the society, then the voting rule should not allow that to be the result of a collective decision making. So when you are a single agent, completely isolated from the rest of the world, there is no need to think about ethical considerations. You are alone, you know, whatever is good or bad, you know, it's up to you and whatever you want to do. But when you are making decisions together with others, so be it a human or artificial agents, you should have shared ethical principles. And with people, we somewhat assume that we have shared ethical principles when we are, you know, making a group decision in a room, but actually with artificial agents, so it's not that clear that this common sense knowledge is there, so we need to put it there. So what are ethical principles? How do we embed these ethical principles into a group decision-making system? Well, ethical principles, in some sense, they are not that different from preferences, because ethical principles are also describing a priority order, possibly with some unacceptability onto the possible decisions. It's saying these decisions are definitely not acceptable because they are not following the ethical principle, and among the ones that are acceptable, I will rank them according to some priority, for example, according to one of the approaches that people use in psychology, which is the consequentialist approach. You say, I look at the consequences of these actions, decisions, and then I rank, I give priority to this decision according to these consequences to maximize the beneficial effect of the decision or to minimize the negative effect. So ethical principles define a priority order as well as moral values that we use, like I value honesty, I value sincerity. This also, in an abstract way, gives you a priority order over the possible actions. So there is a lot of issues to understand which ethical principles and moral values have to be inserted in an artificial agent or in a group decision-making system, of course. And for example, in self-driving cars, just to make one example, there is a lot of discussion about that. But in general, in a group decision-making system, you would like, you know, this principle to be explicit and to be shared among the agents. And this is very important and very connected also to the fact that in order to work and function together with these agents, for example, to take a collective decision together, you need to trust these agents, to trust that they are suggesting or making or providing tools to make decisions that are based on ethical principles that are somewhat aligned to yours, okay? Yours being a human. And it's also this trust can be built also based on another important capability that that artificial agents should have, which is the capability to explain why they are suggesting certain decisions and why not. Suppose, for example, think, for example, of a system that in the health domain makes helps a doctor diagnose or make a suggestion for a therapy. The system suggests the possible therapy. Of course, the system can have access to many more data and make sense to many more data that any doctor in their life can understand or read, but the system should be trusted by the doctor, should be able to explain, for example, why he's suggesting a certain therapy and not another one. So this ethical principle, of course, can be coded directly into the system, and most probably they also have to be, most part, learned over time by observing by other systems or by observing humans. And so, in general, you need to not speak anymore about preferences, but about an ethical form of preferences, because preferences can also be non-ethical. Preferences are just what you prefer, you know, because of your individual taste. But if you look at an ethical group decision making, then you need to, in some way, embed these ethical principles at the individual level, but also at the collective group decision making level. So the voting theory rule that puts together these preferences, even their ethical version, it has to make sure that the collective result is ethical as well. So there are already many people that have worked on areas that are not called ethical principles, but that have looked at making decisions in the face of some constraints that are there. For example, safety constraints. Think about, you know, space applications where situations are very critical. You don't want the mission to fail because otherwise it's a lot of money waste and you cannot do all the experiments that you wanted to do. So then there are many safety constraints and you want to make sure that the probability of failure of the system is very, very low. And so in some sense, this is also something that we think can be used, this expertise can be used in order to embed ethical principles into it. So ethical principles, let's say, is similar to preferences. So you could think, oh, I'll use the preference tools and machinery to embed also ethical principles. But it's also similar and related to safety constraints. So there is also these other lines of work that can be used. So in general here, this is just an example that I gave you to of this general trend in AI now, no? So that we want this AI system to be as effective as possible to reach the goal that you give them, but also to make sure that they do it in a way that does not harm, is not against ethical principle that we want to follow. At IBM, we have an example that we want to pursue, which is what we call a symbiotic environment for group decision making. So imagine a room where people need to make a decision, and the room is part of the decision-making process. In fact, it's supporting the group to make decision. So the meeting room has the goal of acquiring data that is needed for the possible options over which we have to make a decision, make sense of possibly a huge amount of data, elicit the learner, the preferences from the agents, help them with negotiating and trading off their preferences, propose suitable voting rules for that particular scenario, that particular kind of decision that be taken, handle uncertainty, and make sure, as I said, that the collective decision process and the result is ethical. Okay? So, of course, this is not something that this goal that we have is not something that can be done by computer scientists alone. As soon as you touch upon ethical principles, you cannot just, we are not the expert of that. And so we have to, it has to be a multidisciplinary environment involving many different disciplines so neuroscience, machine learning, voting theory, of course, all natural language processing, but also psychology, philosophy, and so on. I recently started a project on embedding ethical principles in collective decision making. This is one of those projects that you may have heard that has been funded by the Future of Life Institute with the Elon Musk money that were that Elon was mentioned before. It's true that he made those very media aggressively media publicized statement about problems, possible problems with AI, but he's also a very constructive guy. So he decided to support a lot of projects, scientific projects, that actually are trying in a positive way to make sure that AI is done in the best way. So this project, as again I said, is multidisciplinary. It involves also people from Harvard, MIT, other universities in the States, and myself. And that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to put ethical principles, understand how to use the existing technology or to adapt it, or to generalize it, to embed ethical principle in group decision making. At IBM, this is to help people make better decision is something that already is a very big line of work. I think the whole Watson initiative, as far as I understand it, because I joined very recently, but it is about that, to help augment human intelligence, to help people make better decision in whatever business they are or everyday life. And so they already have a lot of effort in helping people, individuals, make better decisions. So now what we want to do is actually to help group of people make better decisions, not just individuals. So the point is about intelligent augmentation, not replacement of human decision. I believe strongly that we humans are very complementary to machines. Machines have a lot of strength in handling a lot of data and having a lot of computational power, but we have other strengths that are very complementary, so we can get the best results if we synergically understand how to work synergically together. And so I don't see the future as AI system replacing human intelligent agents, but actually augmenting their capability of making good decisions. So the system that I see in the future are not systems where AI will win against humans or not, but systems combined where AI and human intelligence is actually combined to get the best decision. So I will stop here and get questions. Okay?
Thank you very much for your talk. I have a question about let's talk about hiring, which is just an example of this, hiring people. Mm-hmm. And it turns out, to put it politely, that some of the job boards have gotten to a suboptimal place in terms of finding people. And likewise, HR departments have problems with the automatic filters that have been put in place. It turns out that the best way to do this is still mutually trusted references about who you're hiring. And if you're thinking about your department, you're not going to rely on these tools for an academic hire or your tenure committee. Can you talk about how some of these tools will evolve to a place where they're really useful and can really fill the role of a trusted advocate as opposed to just a statistical filter?
Okay, so as I said, I mean, you need to trust each other and to believe that you are working with the same basic principles underlying all of them. There could be constraints put by other people, the HR people or whatever.
I understand all that. It hasn't gotten to that point. It hasn't worked yet. How do you get beyond these good tools to a place where it's really useful?
So the point is that to talk to, real situations like this one that you are describing, and to make them understand that actually an automated system can actually help them by getting a better decision. And from the department point of view, this is what counts, to get the best people in the department. Okay, and I think that if the department can see that actually what these efforts, or others, not just mine, of course, can provide a better support for reaching that goal, I think that once they get, convinced of that, then they can change their way of functioning and maybe...
Will you use these tools when you're hiring?
Yeah, because these tools are not going to make decisions for the group, but are going to provide all the... all the information and digest them in the right way to be able to, for me and the other people in the committee, to make a better decision. We are still going to make a decision, but will be a more informative decision, and constraints will be taken care of, priorities of other committees are going to be taken care of. So I don't see anything bad of you in using one of these tools.
Hi, how are you? So I understand that you'd like to just augment and not completely replace the human mind, but how do you stop the AI from a point where it just becomes better at making decisions than humans? Because, just past history, and as you've seen various technology sectors, technology is taking over at some point where it just doesn't make sense to have a human in between. It just makes sense to have a computer or a software replace. So how do you stop it where it gets to a point that it's not better than humans in a generalistic term?
Well, I mean, there will be cases in which AI system will actually take over some tasks where the AI system is better than a human. But this, I would not see this as replacing people in general, because as I said, we are very complementary. And if we replace the people because the AI systems are better, I mean, I don't think they will be better at some of the things that are our strengths, for at least for a long, long time. So I think that the future for me is a combination of these two kinds of intelligence rather than a replacement of one or the other one. Okay, I think that we can talk maybe later during the panel or anything other, we can move to the next speaker. Thank you.